ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ओम नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। नारायण नमस्कृत्यां नरं चैवं नरोत्तमं देवीं सरस्वतीं व्यासं ततोऽचयमुदीरयेत्। नस्तापृषु अपात्रेषु नित्यं भगवत्सेवया भगवत्युत्तमश्लोकैर्भक्तिभवति नैस्तिकी। So we read from Srimad Bhagavatam, new chapter, 6th canto, 5th chapter, text 1 to 8. And we read the text, we recite together, text number 8. Nadira Ubyayato Vaham Pancha Panchabhutam Griham Kvachit Tamsam Chitrakatam Kshaura Pavyam Svayam Brahmi Nadim Ubayato Vaham Nadim Ubayato Vaham Pancha Panchat Bhutam Griham Panchat Panchat Bhutam Griham Kvachit Tamsam Chitrakatam Kvachit Tamsam Chitrakatam Kshaura Kshaura Pavyam Svayam Brahmi Kshaura Pavyam Svayam Brahmi Nadim Ubayato Vaham Pancha Panchat Bhutam Griham Kvachit Tamsam Chitrakatam Kshaura Pavyam Svayam Brahmi. Nadim Ubayato Vaham Pancha Panchat Bhutam Griham Kvachit Tamsam Chitrakatam Kshaura Pavyam Svayam Brahmi. Pancha Panchat Bhutam Griham Matajis. Also read the other ones. Uvacha chatta haryashva katam srakshyata vai prachaha atrishvanam puvo yoyam palisha patta palakaha tataika purusham rastram pilam chatrishta nirgamam bahurupam striyam chapi Pumsham sam pumshalipatim Nadim ubayato vaham Pancha panchat putam griham Kvachitam sam chitrakatam Kshaura pavyam svayam brahmi. Uvacha, he said. Cha, also. Atha, thus. Haryashva, O Haryashvas, sons of Prajapati Daksha. Katam Vai Shrakshyata, you will beget. Vai, indeed. Prachaha, Prochani. Atrishtva, having not seen. Antam, the end. Puva, of this earth. Yuyam, all of you. Balisha, inexperienced. Pata, alas. Palakaha, although ruling princes, ruling princesses. Tata, so also. Eka, one. Purusham, man. Rashtram, kingdom. Bilam, the whole. Cha, also. Atrishta, Nirgamam, from which there is no coming out. Bahu Rupam, taking many forms. Striyam, the woman. Cha, and. Api, even. Pumamsam, the man. Pumshchali Patim, the husband of a prostitute. Nadim, a river. Upayata, flowing in both ways. Vaham, which flows. Pancha, pancha, of five multiplied by five, that means 25. Hat Bhutam, a wonder. Griham, the house. Kvachit, somewhere. Hamsam, a swan. Chitrakatam, whose story is very wonderful. Kshaura Pavyam, made of sharp razors and thunderbolts. Svayam, itself. Brahmi, revolving. The great sage Narada said, "My dear Haryashvas, you have not seen the extremities of the earth. There is a kingdom where only one man lives and where there is a hole from which, having entered, no one emerges. A woman there who is extremely unchaste adorns herself with various attractive dresses, and the man who lives there is her husband. In that kingdom, there is a river flowing in both directions. A wonderful home made of 25 materials. A swan that vibrates various sounds. And an automatically revolving object made of sharp razors and thunderbolts. You have not seen all this, and therefore you are inexperienced boys without advanced knowledge. How then will you create progeny?" Purport. Narada Muni saw that the boys known as the Haryashvas were already purified because of living in that holy place and were practically ready for liberation. Why then should they be encouraged to become entangled in family life, which is so dark that once having entered it, one cannot leave it? Through his analogy, Narada Muni asked them to consider why they should follow their father's order to be entangled in family life. Indirectly, he asked them to find within the course of their hearts the situation of the Supersoul, Lord Vishnu. But then they would truly be experienced. In other words, one who is too involved in his material environment and does not look within the core of his heart is increasingly entangled in the illusory energy. Narada Muni's purpose was to get the sons of Prajapati Daksha to divert their attention towards spiritual realization instead of involving themselves in the ordinary but complicated affairs of propagation. The same advice was given by Prahlad Maharaj to his father, quoted from Bhagavatam 7.5.5. Nasatu manye suravarya dehinam sadasamudviknadiyam asakrahat itvatma patam griham andakupam vanam gatoyatarim ashrayata. In the dark well of family life, one is always full of anxiety because of having accepted a temporary body. If one wants to free himself from this anxiety, one should immediately leave family life and take shelter of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in Vrindavan. Narad Muni advised the Haryashvas not to enter household life, since they were already advanced in spiritual knowledge. Why should they be entangled in that way? Also read first all verses together. Srila Shukadev Goswami continued, impelled by the illusory energy of Lord Vishnu, Prajapati Daksha begot 10,000 sons in the womb of Panchajani, Ashikni, his wife name, Ashikni, Panchajani. My dear king, these sons were called or known by as Haryashvas. My dear king, all the sons of Prajapati Daksha were alike in being very gentle and obedient to the orders of their father. When the father ordered them to beget children, they all went in the western direction. In the west, where the river Sindhu meets the sea, there is a great place of pilgrimage known as Narayana Saras. Many sages and others advanced in spiritual consciousness live there. In that holy place, the Haryashvas began regularly touching the lake's waters and bathing in them. Gradually becoming very much purified, they became inclined towards the activities of Paramahamsas. Nevertheless, because their father had ordered them to increase the population, they performed severe austerities to fulfill his desires. One day, when the great sage Narada saw those boys performing such fine austerities to increase the population, Narada approached them. The great sage Narada saying, "My dear Haryashvas, you have not seen the extremities of the earth. There is a kingdom where only one man lives and where there is a hole from which, having entered, no one emerges. A woman there who is extremely unchaste adorns herself in various attractive dresses, and the man who lives there is her husband. In that kingdom, there is a river flowing in both directions, a wonderful home made of 25 materials, a swan that vibrates various sounds, and an automatically revolving object made of sharp razors and thunderbolts. You have not seen all this, and therefore you are inexperienced boys without advanced knowledge. How then will you create progeny?" Gananjana Salakyam Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasma Shri Gurave Namaha. Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadha Shri Vasudi Gaura Bhaktavrinda. Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare Hare, Hare Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So Daksha, meaning of Daksha means he was expert in creating offsprings. He was an empowered personality. Long time ago he lived. He had two lives described in the Bhagavatam. Previous life he was son of Brahma. Second life he became the son of the Prajetas. And there is a certain empowered personalities in this in universe is called Prajapati. The original Prajapati is Lord Brahma. He's the creator of the universe. And he has a desire, he has the job to create this universe and also populate it with all kinds of living entities. I mean species of life, 8,400,000 species of life. Prototypes are existing in this material universe. And in all these bodies, the different spirit souls become manifest, sometimes unmanifest, if they are in avyakta or in not manifested stage, and sometimes they become manifested in the different species of life according to their past karma. So the karma is always registered somewhere, and according to when the creation takes place, living entities who are conditioned in this material world have to take birth again, and are put in different species of life. And there are certain agents who are helping Brahma to help living entities to receive material bodies, especially also human form of life, and they're called the Prajapatis. And the most important one of these Prajapatis, besides Brahma, is Daksha. So he was very expert. So he created 10,000 sons in one time. So not only one or two or five or 12, 10,000. So he was, because he was very eager to populate the world with his descendants, Daksha dynasty. Daksha dynasty means he was not interested in pure devotional service. He wanted to create children with a mission that they also will follow the footsteps of their father. That means family business. Family business of Daksha was to create children. Daksha, therefore, he expected from his sons. First, he didn't create the girls. He wanted to have sons to create 10,000 sons multiplied if they also create many thousands of children. He hoped, it will be a great success for my family line and for my mission. Because it was in Vedic time, so the father, he has a saying, and he tells to the sons, before you enter family life, before you be married with a qualified mataji or girl, you have to perform tapasya. You have to become purified. You have to get the tejas, the strength, to become powerful grihastha. So to become a powerful grihastha or a successful grihastha, one has to be a good brahmachari first. And that means one has to perform a certain amount of tapasya and following certain rules and regulations given in the scriptures and given by the father. In this instance, Daksha, he was the father, so he told them, he gave them the order, you go there to that holy place, that holy river on the western side of India, and the Sindhu River. Place known as Narayana Sara. Narayana Sara. Somebody knows where it is? So anyway, it's a very ancient story. So there in India, Sparatavasha, many holy places. And one should perform austerity and stay for some time at a holy place or even whole life, to perform a certain amount of vow or vows Because the vows performed in a holy place, in a tirtha, is more powerful than in an ordinary place. So these sons of Daksha, known as Haryashvas, the father sent them to that holy place, to that tirtha, to perform austerities for some time before they entered the Grihastha ashram. So he didn't tell them, so here you have just girls, marry them and be happy and multiply yourself and enjoy life. So no, he told her, before you enjoy life, multiply and enjoy life, you have to perform austerity. So that was a good advice. The bad advice was, the goal was only to create children. And whatever will happen with that, with those children, who knows, if they don't have spiritual training. So spiritual training, a proper vision, higher vision or purpose of life has to be given by the father or by the spiritual master. The father is mostly the guru of the boy, of the child. He not necessarily gives the spiritual mission, but he gives a mission of success in life, material life. He's well-wishing, he wants to give his sons good advice how to become happy and successful in life, so, and he gives them all support, but he cannot liberate them. The father itself cannot liberate the sons. But the father can give advice to the sons that they can become liberated by connecting them with spiritual master. But the Haryashvas, the sons of Daksha, were not ordered for spiritual activities with the purpose of for liberation. They were ordered to perform austerities and purify themselves so they become to just create children, to have nice family life. He didn't connect them with spiritual master, but the spiritual master comes on his own accord, sent by the Supreme Lord. Yasa Prasada Bhagava Prasado, Yasa Prasada Nagati Kodobi. We don't have to call him. He will come. Guru is coming. He's sent by Krishna. He's Krishna's agent. Krishna sends Guru. Guru is coming, even if we don't invite him. Like Srila Prabhupada, he told, nobody invited me to come to the West. Nobody sent me a ticket to come that I come to the West or an invitation. So I came on my own accord because I was sent by my Guru Maharaj. And Prabhupada also told, my father, he gave me so many things. He teach me he teach me how to worship deities. He told me how I should learn Midanga. Prabhupada became very expert Midanga player. He also became very good cook. He learned cooking at home. So from his parents, especially from his father, he learned so many things. But one thing he could not learn, one thing the father could not give him, the mission. The mission of spreading Krishna consciousness is not given by the father, it is given by the spiritual father, by the spiritual master. So the spiritual master is injecting the sincere disciple with the transcendental mission. And the first mission is to become, the spiritual master wants that that the disciple becomes liberated himself. Because if he becomes liberated, disentangled from fruitive activities, who are bounding us in this material world, then he is able to liberate others. If we are not ourselves liberated, we cannot liberate others. So therefore, the disciple himself has to be liberated by following the instruction of his Guru Maharaj. And by following the instruction of his Guru Maharaj, then because this instruction is the instruction of liberation, of becoming liberated from the cycle of birth and death, he will connect us with this instruction to the lotus feet of Krishna, so that the disciple can take shelter at the lotus feet of Krishna. Now, that's one thing, but the spiritual master not only thinks about how the disciple become liberated himself, he also likes that the disciple would follow the family business of the Guru Maharaj, to spread Krishna consciousness, to liberate the living entities, and bringing them to the original father, to Krishna. So that's the purpose. And so in this way, the family of devotees is increased. So there's two ways how we can increase the family, either by simial descendants, like the Prachetas or Prajapatis, or then by a transcendental mission, by the preaching and expanding Krishna consciousness process. One is called Chuta, and the other one is called Achuta Gotra. So there are two Gotras. Either we are in the line from the Chuta, fallible line, coming from family through simial descendants, or you are become a descendant of Achuta Gotra. Achuta Gotra means the infallible family line, coming from the Supreme Personality of Godhead and of his pure devotees. They're called Achuta Gotra. It's Achuta Gotra. In India, especially if you go to the Jagannath Puri temple, they ask you, which Gotra you belong? So you have to say them, you are from Gautama Gotram, I'm from Bhrigu Gotram, I'm from this and that famous Brahma descendants Gotram. No. But sometimes you can also tell them, yes, I'm from Achyuta Gotram. No. And they have to let you in. Of course, if they see that you are white skinned, they don't let you in, even though you are from Achyuta Gotram. The infallible line. Anyway, it doesn't matter if you can enter the Jagannath temple or not, because even many of the devotees, of intimate devotees of Lord Chaitanya, like Sanatana Goswami, Rupa Goswami, Srila Haridas Thakur, they didn't enter the Jagannath temple, because they didn't consider themselves Brahmanas. They considered themselves very Nietzsche, very low, very fallen, because they were not born in Brahmana families. Although Sanatana Rupa Goswami were born in Brahmana families, but because of their employment amongst Muslim government, the Hindu system was such strong, strict, you know, that they had to give up their caste as Brahmanas, and they became known as Mlechas and Yavanas, not followers, strict followers of Vedic rules and regulations, not Aryans. So, therefore, they considered themselves, we don't want to make any disturbance, create any disturbance, we don't even make an attempt to enter the Jagannath temple. Although they could do, they were associates of Lord Chaitanya. Lord Chaitanya could take them in. But no, Lord Chaitanya respected this rule. And Sanatana Goswami, Rupa Goswami respected this rule. The Haridas Thakur accepted that rule. And therefore the Lord told them, you just offer obeisances to the chakra on the top of the temple. And there's also Jagan Mohan, Patita Pavana, Jagannath, who is outside of the temple. You can offer obeisances and prayers to him. But the very interesting thing is that Jagannath in the form of Lord Chaitanya always came to see Sanatana Rupa and Haridas Thakur. So they didn't want to break this rule and regulation,
although they were actually above the Varnashram system, they were better than Brahmana. Because when a Brahmana cannot liberate himself, then he's not better than a Shudra or a dog eater. That's Shastra's statement. But if a dog eater will become a Vaishnava, or a Mlecha, Yavana, or a Shudra, or anyone, never mind what kind of a past life one had, doesn't matter in devotional service, one becomes elevated by the mercy of Krishna and by the mercy of the process to the highest level of Brahmana. Brahmana means Brahman Jana Iti Brahmana. Brahmana means he who knows Brahman. If a Brahmana doesn't know Brahman, is not acting towards Brahman, Brahman realization, or attaining the Supreme Personality of Godhead, then it's actually not a real Brahmana. So Brahmana is not some caste as we know. So Brahmana means he who knows the Supreme Lord, who is acting for the Supreme Lord's benefit, for his satisfaction. So he's a Brahmana. And he also is kind to all living entities. He sees in everyone the Supreme Lord, the Super Soul, and is doing good for everyone. So he's not sectarian. So Brahmana means sadhu. He's not Kripana. Kripana means he who is miser. He only thinks about himself, my family, my business, my interest, my profit. So this is the egoism, why we are in this material world. But the spiritual masters in the Achyuta Gotram, like Narad Muni, he's the leader of them. They have no interest in material existence. And they are very merciful by nature. So they want to help the lost conditioned souls who fell in this material creation to come out of it, to connect them with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Therefore, Narada and his disciplic succession coming from Brahma, Narada, Vyasa, to Madhva, and so on, Lord Chaitanya and all his followers. It's Achyuta Gotram. This is the infallible line, helping us, giving all the conditioned soul the mercy to reconnect themselves with the Supreme Lord, with our original Father. So, like Narada, he's very, very much interested in helping living entities in the human form of life, especially because that's the privilege of human form of life, that they use their time properly in Krishna consciousness, in Krishna conscious activities. And he's always coming at a certain time when he sees somebody is qualified already for the transcendental instruction. So he doesn't want to waste him time to preach or to speak to those who are not qualified, who are not interested. Prabhupada also told, if a place is not suitable for accepting the message of Krishna consciousness, then we should try it another place. We should try out different ways and different places where the people are ready for it. Of course, nobody is really always ready for it. So if nobody is ready for it, like in Kali Yuga, then one has to try best and pray to Krishna, please send me one conditioned soul who is ready, who is open for this, to hear about the message of Krishna consciousness. So the devotee prays in this way, I got this mission. It's an impossible mission to help the conditioned souls. Please send me somebody who will accept the book or who is listening to the message so that they can become benefited. Most of the people have no interest. But if somebody has an interest, or if some place is suitable, or becomes qualified and open to hear for Christian consciousness, then one immediately should go there and give those people and those candidates the best information for their best interest. One should not cheat them then. We should not cheat them and give them something inferior if you know something superior. So therefore, at Vaishnava, in the Achyuta Gotra line, he never wants to give a process inferior because he knows the Paravidya, the supreme goal of life, transcendental knowledge. He doesn't want to give them inferior knowledge about astrology, psychology, Ayurveda, and all this. This is all secondary means. This is not the main means of human form of life. The main means of human form of life is to give them the Paravidya, the transcendental knowledge, and to reconnect them with Krishna. Then everything else is maybe needed or not, most properly not needed. Because wherever we have Krishna in our center, you know, then we have the best astrological star, Krishnaksha, we have above our head. That means everything becomes suspicious. And if we don't have Krishna, then what is the value? Like Narada Muni, it's in Narada Pancharatra. Narada Muni says, Aradito yadi haris tapasa tatha kim, naradito yadi haris tapasa tatha kim. If one worships Lord Krishna and considers him the goal of life, then there is no need to execute severe types of austerity or tapasya. And if after executing all kinds of tapasya, one cannot reach Krishna, then all this tapasya has no value. For without Krishna consciousness, different types of austerities are a wasted labor. So that means if we cannot attain Krishna with tapasya, what is the use of tapasya? And if we can attain Krishna without tapasya, what is the use of tapasya? This is Narad Muni. So Narad Muni, he therefore thinks, oh, here are personalities, qualified, their sons, boys, proper age, they're not old men, they're young, they're full of life energy and hopes and desires, and they're even ready to follow rules and regulations, to perform a certain kind of tapasya, to become purified, so they're very qualified. Why they're just engaged for family life? Why they only want to have children and to perform this kind of tapasya and this kind of activities to live in a holy place? These animals also, monkeys live in the holy place, and they multiply themselves to thousands and millions, almost more than human inhabitants. So it's not the goal of life to live in a holy place, to just to multiply himself, to expand himself, but to practice and to take deep the process of Krishna consciousness. So this is Narad Muni, therefore instructing, he approached the Haryashvas to give them the highest instruction. But he gave it them not directly. It's typical Narada. Narada, he always, or many times, he speaks indirectly in form of an analogy, enigmatic. Someone has to, not very easy to find out what he actually means. So therefore in this verse, Narada, in a couple of verses, he gave the Prachetas 10 advices. 10 advices analogical way. He spoke about a land. He spoke about a man who lives in a certain land. Then he spoke about then he spoke about a man and a woman, a prostitute and a man who is the husband of this woman.
Then he spoke about
a river who has two currents.
And then he spoke about
a hole where if one lives there or falls in that hole, one never comes back. Then I spoke about 25 elements.
Then he spoke about a swan, and he spoke about a sharp wheel,
sharper like a razor. So in the next 10 verses, these 10 points are described in each and every one verse with the purport.
That will be the future lectures then. So the earth,
Bhuvi,
is the place of or field of activity. I only give it short. That we get a grasp and an idea.
Earth or Bhuvi means the activity. That means we have on the earth we have an opportunity in human form of life to perform karma, either akarma or vikarma, or karma. So it's our choice or our luck if we can engage in akarma or in naishkarma, that means in without attachment to the fruitive activities. But in general, this field is the of earth is a field of karma, that means of activities, mostly in fruitive activities. And Narada Muni, therefore, he thought, Oh, sons of Daksha, you should not use your time in fruitive activity, in karma yoga, in purification of your activities for a material purpose, but use it to attain the highest purpose, you know, engage in nice karma, in devotional service. Then the second one is the Purusha, the man who lives alone in his abode. This is the Supreme Personality of Godhead who lives in the Vaikuntha planets. That's the goal. So that's a person who lives there, the Purusha. It's Mahapurusha, Purushottama. So then, but then opposite of Vaikuntha is a hole. It's Patala Loka system. And everyone who follows in this Patala Loka system, that means in this Bila Svarga, it's also another name of Patala or the lower plant resistance, is Bilva Svarga. Subterranean hellish planets. Subterranean heavenly planets, actually. Bilva Svarga. But there's no sunshine. And there are no pious people live there. So whoever lives falls down in this Patala Loka. Patala Loka has 7 systems underneath the earth. Patala, Talatala, Vitala, Sutala, like that. So there are 7 of them. And then there are 7 hires who are going towards the sun, beginning with Bhuloka, Bhuvar, Svarga, Jana, Tapa, like that. So there are the 7 higher planets. And the human form of life on the earth planet is in the middle plant resistance. And everyone who falls in this hole of darkness where there's no sunlight, there are only snakes who have a very brilliant, diamonds on their heads who give some kind of reflection of the sunlight. And that sheds some kind of light. So whoever falls in that dark hole, known as Patala, but it's very rarely seen that somebody came back to the earth or going higher. And then the next one is the prostitute. The prostitute who is always changing the dress is very whimsical, unsteady. It represents the intelligence. The intelligence is, if it is not fixed on Supreme Personality of Godhead, Yavasatmika Buddhir, Ekya Kuranandana, then the intelligence becomes Bahushaka, becomes many-branched. And the many-branched intelligence have so many ideas. These ideas are all, and plans and desires, they're all considered different kinds of dresses of a prostitute. And the man who is married with this prostitute, that means who lives with her first, and becomes attracted to that prostitute, is the conditioned soul. And when the conditioned soul becomes attracted to it and becomes connected with the material intelligence, not with the pure intelligence, but with the material intelligence, if he becomes connected or attached to her and influenced, it falls under her influence. So the man, the conditioned soul, who is actually a free soul, becomes, due to that attachment, he becomes an instrument under the influence of the prostitute, and therefore become and has to act like madman. So he becomes completely bewildered in his position as an eternal servant of Krishna. So he loses his identity, and he's only running after the prostitute and try to fulfill her whimsical desires. So he becomes bound up by the material intelligence. Then this is a description of a river. A river who has two currents. And these currents are very strong, especially on the border, on the borderline of the river of material existence, of samsara, of birth and death, where constant birth and death is taking place. That means the river of creation and destruction. This is the Maya. It's actually Maya River. The material existence is described sometimes as a river who has two powerful currents, and the currents are very strong, especially on the shore side, on the, how we call it, on the boundary, on the riverbed. There is very strong. So one flow goes up and one goes down. So it means this creations and destruction is taking place. Then we have 25 elements. So that means the person, the soul with intelligence together, lives in the body with 25 elements. So we have we start with the subtle to go to the cross. So the subtle consciousness of material identification is called citta. That's the 25th element, citta. It's the polluted consciousness of material awareness. That's citta. That's described by Kapila Dev in the third canto, Sankhya, Bhakti Sankhya. We have the intelligence, the false ego, the mind. So these are 24. And then we have the Mahatattva. Mahatattva. So these are five elements. They're more subtle. Mahatattva is a combined subtle program of all material existence. So Mahatattva, Chitta, Buddhi, intelligence, false ego, intelligence, mind, five elements. Then we have the Karmendriyas, Gyanendriyas, five, and the sense objects, five, that's 15, plus five, 20. And then we have the five elements, earth, water, fire, air, and ether. So makes another five, makes 25. So this material body is a combination of these 25 elements described in the Sankhya of the Canto of Lord Kapiladeva's teachings. And then the next thing is the swan. The swan represents the Vedic hymns, the Vedic mantras. So the instruction of the Shastra, the instruction of the Vedas, it's like a hamsa, like a swan. So the swan has a nature to extract the essence. We can differentiate what is sat and what is asat, what is temporary, what is eternal. So on the hamsa, he extracts the essence, the milk, the nectar of immortality, that means spiritual activities. So by the Vedic hymns, one can learn how to understand what is Atma, what is Brahman, what is eternal, and what is material, what is Prakriti, what is material nature, how it is combined. And it gives us intelligence or direction, knowledge, in which direction to go. And therefore, the Vedic literatures are the father. They are the father, the real father. It becomes represented through scriptures and through the spiritual master. So the first father, he gives us the body, he gives us the facility for life, to exist in this material world, in the world of karma, but the spiritual father, the Vedas, and the spiritual master who represents the Vedas, who is teaching the Vedas, they give us the seed of devotional service. And if one receives the seed of devotional service, one is considered happy, because then one becomes deadless. Otherwise, the tenth subject or point what Narada in the analogy made is the razor's blade. This propeller was like a thunderbolt. You see sometimes thunderbolts, like in Bengal, we see the thunderbolts. They're always circulating around like that, like a chakra thunderbolts. They can be very dangerous. And they always, sometimes they're visible, sometimes they're not visible. They come and go. And so this thunderbolt or this razor, this chakra represents kala, the time aspect. So everyone has a certain time. And Bhagavatam states one has to use one's time for spiritual activities, not for material activities. Because when every sunrise and sunset, arharahate vaipumsham, by every sunrise and sunset, the lifespan of an embodied living entity becomes shortened. But somebody who is engaging his life for the service of Krishna, the all-good personality of Godhead, he will not become defeated by the time aspect. So therefore, those who use the time in studying the Vedas or the essence of Vedas, following the spiritual master's instruction, this is the purpose of life. And the Narada Muni, in the disciplic succession, his teaching just this process, nothing else, because he wants to give the devotees or people the best opportunity, the best gift. So that's his great mercy. Because there are two kinds of literature. One is Hamsa literature, other is crow literature. Those who are crow-like people or consciousness, they only like to live in the pilgrimage or in place where there's garbage. This worldly literature is like crow literature. And Hamsa literature, Narad Muni in the fifth chapter of first canto to Srila Vyasadeva Shiksha, he tells that the Hamsa literature of Srimad Bhagavatam, this is another kind of creation. Tatvak visargo chanataga viplavo yasmin pratishloka abdavati api. Namnam nananti shonkintanti va chrinvanti gyanti krinanti sadhava. Because it creates a revolution, a change in the heart of the misguided civilization. It gives us the proper direction to go. And therefore, everyone who hears this transcendental literature, Srimad Bhagavatam, who is Paramahamsa literature, who is especially appreciated by the Paramahamsa class of men, who have no more attachment to this material world, who know what is Sat and what is Asat, and who therefore go for the Sat, for the eternal activity, for the Shreyas, for them, Bhagavatam becomes very interesting. So Bhagavatam is not only for Paramahamsa in the order of Paramahamsa, for Tridanti Sannyasi. Paramahamsa is an attitude, is a mentality, is a consciousness. And that we all can try to achieve by following in the instruction of Spiritual Master, following in the line of Narad Muni. Then everyone has an opportunity to become Paramahamsa. And how you become Paramahamsa? By always practicing or following the principles of Bhagavatam. The Bhagavatam itself is Paramahamsa literature. As stated in the end, in the 12th canto, 13th chapter, text 18, Srimad Bhagavatam Puranam Amalam Yat Vaishnavanam Priyam Yasmim paramahamsyam ekam amalam jnanam param giyate tatra jnana viraga bhakti sahitam naishkarmyam avishkritam tachtrinvan supatan vicharana paro bhaktya vimuchen naraha. Srimad Bhagavatam is a spotless Purana. It is most dear to the Vaishnavas because it describes the pure and supreme knowledge of the Paramahamsas. Therefore, the Vaishnavas are like Hamsas, supreme swans. They don't like to read crow literature. They only, because crows and Hamsas, you don't see them together. They have two different places where they live. So those who are Hamsa-like, whose mentality is like swan, they live in the place of Krishna Katha. They become attracted to Vichitra Katha, very attractive to the Katha of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. This Bhagavatam reveals the means for becoming free from all material work, together with the process of transcendental knowledge, renunciation, and devotion. Anyone who seriously tries to understand Srimad Bhagavatam, who properly hears and chants it with devotion, becomes completely liberated. That means he will become fit to become an associate of the Lord and attain shelter at his lotus feet. Hare Krishna. Granta Raj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai. Maybe a question? One? I have time. Okay. Yeah. Can you give a microphone? That's good.
And then he said, instead, I will open a center, a Jagannath temple.
Yes. And that the Jagannath will come to us.
Which by the grace of the Lord, we will be there
for
some days, which
is But now you see, they want to build a temple, and now the temple of Jagannath, the organization, they want to stop it. Because they know this prophecy, that one time Jagannath will leave and he will go to another place. There's a prophecy in Jagannath Puri. And they're afraid, you know, oh, that Jagannath will come to that temple. And then, therefore they want to stop it. They're very, I don't want to speak too much political about that. They have their ways, so we have to, therefore Lord Chaitanya accepted their ways, he respected that. No, he came there for seeing the darshan of Lord Jagannath, and he didn't saw Jagannath in the way as the Jagannath Puri Vasi see him, with four arms, as Narayana, no, or as Krishna in Dwaraka, where sometimes two arms, sometimes four arms. They saw Lord Chaitanya only saw him as a cowherd boy, with the flute, with the cowherd stick. And that what he was seeing already in the beginning when he came to Jagannath Puri, from distance, 20 kilometers from Jagannath Puri, or 10 kilometers, maybe not so far, but from sight, he could see from the distance the Krishna on the top of the temple. Come here, as a cowherd boy, come here. I want to see Lord Chaitanya was rushing, he was running there as swiftly as possible. And therefore he fainted in front of Lord Jagannath, because he didn't saw the Lord as Jagannath, as the Lord of universe, as Narayana or Dwarakadish. He saw him as Krishna in Vrindavan. Gopal. That was Lord Chaitanya's. And only due to Lord Chaitanya, this is actually revealed. Who actually Lord Jagannath is, where his heart is. His heart is in Vrindavan. So for us, if you are in Vrindavan anyway, it doesn't matter what is going on in Jagannath Puri. Because Lord Jagannath is not there, his heart is here in Vrindavan. As we know. Other question? Okay. Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Thank you.